times, 4 weeks of whole last year, I think, was observing. But this was the week that I was there, so I'm extremely grateful for that happening. And then we started getting all the messages, emails, SMSs, WhatsApps. Something is going on, massive event. Some people wanted to keep it secret because it's the LIGO is kind of a close, it's a big collaboration, but still it's a close collaboration. But at the same time, optical astronomers started looking, so what's changed? There was a gamma ray burst, and I think my next picture shows, yeah. So essentially what happens then is that the LIGO and Virgo themselves, it's not a telescope in a normal sense that you can pinpoint exactly where the wave comes from, but you can deduce, you can sort of say which part of the sky it comes from. And now it was seen in the two of them, you can get a patch of sky where it likely came from. The gamma ray telescopes, they also give an error circle. So the end result is that you get this green thing over there on the, you get a patch of sky where it likely came from. So now everybody on the southern hemisphere and equatorial areas who had a telescope, they dropped everything that they were doing, including us in Sutherland, and you started skimming through, scanning through that region of what happened there. You know, has something changed? And it's best to do with small telescopes, which have a large field of view, and in fact, other people are much smarter than that. They cataloged all the galaxies in that area and started looking at the galaxies one by one. And yeah, so that was a massive hunt which started. So we were part of it at SALT. We just canceled our anything else we were doing that night and started, you know, went for this event. We made several other telescopes as well. And eventually what happened was a telescope in Chile was the first one who detected that something had changed in just outside one galaxy, about 130 million light years away. And they got it quite late in Chile. They didn't have time to get the big telescopes to take any follow-up observations. The next one, if you think of it, you know, night falls in, when night falls in Chile, then the next night will be in Australia on the other side of the globe. They're, you know, whatever, 9 hours ahead of us. But it was bad weather at their biggest places over there. They didn't really get a good spectrum. And we're 6 hours ahead of Chile. So Chile has the most telescopes on the planet, by the way, because it has the driest deserts. So both themselves and the Europeans and Americans and many others have built a lot of telescopes in Chile. But we're ahead of them, right? So we had a chance to get it before all those telescopes in Chile. We're 6 hours ahead. So that's why it was important for us to use all these facilities in Sutherland. There's a couple of the small ones, Russian Master Telescope there that we work with. SALT, obviously, is a Japanese telescope we work with, and several others. And sure enough, we did. So one of our images, okay, it's difficult to see in this reproduction, but there's a little dot over there. So this is a galaxy over there, there's a little dot over there, one over there, which wasn't there the previous day or the previous hour. It just had happened. So what we did at SALT was then we took a spectrum. So spectrum, for those of you who don't know, essentially you just spread the light into all its different wavelengths, rainbow essentially, that's most of our understanding of where things are come from. Not from images only, but from the spectrum. And essentially when all was said and done after a couple of days, we got a spectrum of it over here, which is one day after the gravitational wave event. And the first proper one of the whole thing, which we are very proud of. So this was, eventually when this was published in putting together all the information in from all the telescopes, there were over 70 observatories who were taking data. 3,000, 4,000 astronomers who were part of that paper. And the SALT spectrum is the very first one. So this picture is actually from that main scientific paper publishing it. And our SALT spectrum is the very first one, which we're very proud of, working together with everybody. Here's a little bit later on, a couple of few days later, the Hubble Space Telescope took a much nicer image. So this is a big, so the same galaxy you saw previously is now really zooming in over there, but that's the event there. So again, we saw it last August, but it had actually happened in the Cretaceous geological era of Earth, you know, this is before T-Rexes were roaming from the Earth, 130 million years ago, but we saw it now in August. And why we think it's so important is this, the way I like to often illustrate it is that it was opening up a new sense. So the name we've given it is multi-messenger astronomy. It's like you've been seeing the universe so far, you know, seeing what happens over there. 2 years ago, 3 years ago, with the first gravitational wave event, you heard something. So the gravitational wave is like a, you know, you can think of it as hearing. You heard something. Opened up a new sense to the universe, a new way of understanding it. But you couldn't put them together because you didn't know what exactly caused that wave. But now, in this moment, you actually saw an explosion and you saw the wave. So you heard and you saw the same. So it's like, you know, me looking, hearing your voices versus seeing you, but putting them both together, you can imagine how much more you can get out of the universe if you actually hear a person speak, right? And, okay, so this is a slide of a couple of the papers that we were involved with, and there's more than 100 scientific publications of this event already now in half a year, and massive amount of research going into what does it mean, how does the universe work, what can you use gravitational waves in, and more. You can peer into the centers of stars, or even close to the Big Bang. There's, you know, opportunities are amazing what you can use them for. So of this particular explosion, what did we then learn? I mean, what was it? Okay, so including people at SAO who were studying this and all the others putting together, this is what it looks like. It was a merger of two neutron stars. So neutron stars are remnants of normal stars which have essentially ended their lives. So just as a reminder, what a star is. Star is a glowing fusion reactor. It's a ball of gas which is turning hydrogen to helium and releasing energy, okay? So when it produces energy, the energy radiation pushes it outward, but because it has a huge mass, gravity pulls it inward, and there's a delicate balance, and that's why our sun is shining, that's why it's stable for billions of years. There's this balance between the radiation going outward and gravity pulling it inward. But one day, the fuel ends. There's not enough hydrogen fuel to fuse into helium and to release that energy. So what happens is that you only have the gravity left, which crunches it together, it collapses. And then depending on what the mass of the star is, there's different kinds of scenarios, but in a certain types of masses, the inner parts really collapse into extremely dense things. So imagine if the whole sun, which is a 1.5 million kilometers big, if you crunch that to the size of 10 kilometers. So here you have a neutron star, and that's the map of Cape Town region. Okay, so a city size, but star mass. So that's a neutron star, extremely dense. So space curves and bends incredibly much around these kinds of objects because they're so extreme, so dense. And now if you have two of them, they move around each other in enormous speed. Okay, I think I have a little video over here. So when they lose energy when they go around each other, they bend the space, they create those waves, but because it loses energy, they kind of in spiral. And eventually they merge, they hit each other, boom, and there's a massive explosion. And for a few seconds, this explosion creates more energy, actually about 50 times more energy than the whole universe taken together. It's unbelievable amount of energy that you produce from that kind of an explosion, and that's why you can then can imagine that it's not only the light and the energy coming out of it, but it really disturbs the space-time continuum itself. Even if it happened 130 million light years away, or even if it happened 2 billion light years away, you would still get that disturbance in the force, you know, disturbance in the space-time continuum. And that's what we did.